Chalo, let's write some notes under section 50C. First bullet point. Where there is a transfer, where there is a transfer of immovable property, of immovable property, comma, being land, building or both, being land, building or both, comma, being a capital asset, being a capital asset, and the sale consideration declared, and the sale consideration declared is less than SDV. What is SDV? Stamp duty value. And the sale consideration declared is less than SDV, comma, as per section 50C, as per section 50C, comma, for the purpose of computation of capital gains, for the purpose of computation of capital gains, such SDV shall be taken as sale consideration. Such SDV shall be taken as sale consideration. Second bullet point. As a recourse available to the SSE, as a recourse available to the SSE, Mori, comma, where the SSE claims, where the SSE claims that the fair market value, that the fair market value is less than the stamp duty value, is less than the stamp duty value, comma, the AO, who is AO? Assessing officer. May appoint VO. Who is VO? Valuation officer. The AO may appoint VO. Full stop. The VO, the VO, after noting all facts and circumstances, all facts and circumstances, the VO, after noting all facts and circumstances, shall issue a valuation report, shall issue valuation report, comma, based on which, based on which assessment is to be completed, assessment is to be completed. Are we clear? And last but not the least, what did we learn? If there is an agreement for sale prior to the date of registration, can we take the stamp duty value as existing on the date of agreement for sale? Yes, provided certain consideration is received in a mode other than by way of cash. Let's write down third bullet point. Where the SSE has entered into an agreement for sale much prior to the date of registration, comma, the SDV as on such date if number one, a part of the consideration is received on or before the date of such agreement for sale, number two, the consideration is received by account to pay check, comma, account pay bank draft, or ECS, account pay check, comma, account pay bank draft, comma, ECS. Electronic clearance system, NEFT, RTGS, net banking, whatever you may call it. Are we clear with section 50C? Next, let's go to the new section introduced by Finance Act 2017, and that is section 50CA. Special provision for full value of consideration for transfer of share other than quoted share, where the consideration received or accruing as a result of the transfer by an SSE of a capital asset being share of a company other than quoted share is less than the fair market value of such share determined in such manner as may be prescribed, the value so determined shall, for the purpose of section 48, be deemed to be the full value of consideration received or accruing as a result of such transfer. Explanation: for the purpose of this section, quoted share means a share quoted on any recognized stock exchange with regularity from time to time, where the quotation of such share is based on current transaction made in the ordinary course of business. So, what is Section 50CA telling us? Saying, if there is any person, what is he transferring? Share. Can I say unquoted? Because he says other than quoted, so I'll say unquoted shares. And obviously in return he's getting certain amount of consideration. What the section says is, if this certain amount of consideration is less than the fair market value, then for the purpose of computation of capital gains, sale consideration shall be taken as fair market value. In other words, it is similar to Section 50C. Section 50C is for immovable property, being land, building or both. Section 50CA is for unquoted shares. Section 50C makes reference to stamp duty value. 50CA makes reference to fair market value. Are we clear? Section 50C has a recourse. Section 50CA need not have a recourse. Why? Because in 50C it is stamp duty value. That means without looking into the facts and circumstances, it is a standard benchmark fixed by the state government. But in Section 50CA, they are using the words fair market value. So, because by default directly you are taking fair market value, the SSE can never make a claim saying that the fair market value is less than the fair market value. Correct or not? There, you are taking stamp duty value, and that is why you needed the recourse. Here, you are directly taking fair market value. Are we clear with this? This is applicable from assessment year 18-19. Correct or not? Come on, write down. First bullet point. Where the SSE transfers unquoted shares for consideration less than fair market value, comma, as per Section 50CA, comma, for the purposes of computation sale consideration shall be taken as fair market value. Sorry? If consideration is more than fair market value, will the section apply? No, section only will not apply. So you will take actually what is the consideration. That's okay. Are we clear with Section 50CA? Next, let's go to Section 50D. Section 50D says, fair market value deemed to be full value of consideration in certain cases. Let me take a small example so that you understand what I am trying to tell. Let us say I wanted to sell one small flat that I have, and Mahesh came forward and said, "Sir, I'd like to buy the flat." I said, "Okay, what is your offer?" He said, "My offer is a little teda, but you like it." I said, "Okay, what is it? Please tell." So he said, "You give me this flat, then what I'll do, I'll finish my CA and then I'll come and teach at Gyan Academy free of cost for 10 years. Is it a good offer?"
"No."
"For not for you, for me. Is it a good offer for me?"
"Yes."
"Yes, assuming that he is going to turn into a very good lecturer. For me, it's actually a very good offer to get lecturer for 10 years. So I accept the offer. Now I want to know, you understood the offer, right? You understood the agreement, you understood the agreement between the transferor and the transferee. Transferor is giving the land, transferee is giving services after must be 3-4 years for a period of 10 years. What is sale consideration?"
"Teaching for 10 years."
"Obviously, you will say fair market value is teaching for 10 years. Come on, tell me the fair market value for teaching for 10 years. Sorry? There is no such thing called as package to lecturer. Fair market value of asset. That's exactly what section says. Section says, in certain scenarios when you cannot find out the fair market value of the consideration received, do one thing. Find out the fair market value of the consideration that you gave. What is the asset you transferred? Flat. Do you think flat will have a fair market value?
Yes.
Chalo, usko le lo sale consideration. That is only your sale consideration. Correct or not? So section 50D is quite small, simple and sweet. Says, where the consideration received or accruing as a result of transfer of capital asset by an SSE chargeable to tax as capital gains, the fair market value of the said asset on the date of transfer shall be deemed to be the full value of consideration received or accruing as a result of such transfer. One page before it, on page number 104 itself, just write down analysis of section 50D. Put heading there, analysis of section 50D. I did not leave space there. Under analysis, write down where, first bullet point, where the value of sale consideration received, the value of sale consideration received is unascertainable. Is unascertainable comma for the purpose of computation of capital gains, for the purpose of computation of capital gains, sale consideration is equal to sale consideration is equal to FMV of asset transferred. FMV of asset transferred. Are we clear with section 50, 50A, 50B, 50C, 50CA and 50D? Yes. Now we go on to a very important section, and that is section 51. Now, before we touch upon section 51, there is one thing that I would like to touch upon, and that is, in income tax, the law, so-called law, you are taxing only income. You are taxing only income. The thumb rule that we follow is all revenue receipts are taxable. Correct or not? All revenue receipts are taxable unless they are exempt under section 10 or some other section. All revenue receipts are taxable unless they are exempted. So, if somebody asks you, dividend, it is a revenue receipt, actually it's taxable, but it became exempt because of section 10, clause 34. Correct or not? Salary, taxable. Income from profession, taxable. Any revenue receipt is taxable unless it is exempt under section 10 or any other exemption section. Whereas, capital receipts are not to be taxed unless specifically taxed. Capital receipts are not to be taxed unless specifically taxed. And you know one section which talks about capital receipts, and that is section 45 subsection 1. Section 45 subsection 1 says, if there is a capital gains arising from the transfer of a capital asset, then only there will be tax. Yes or no? That means you have to check if it's a transfer, you have to check if it's a capital asset, then the capital receipt will be subjected to tax. Otherwise, will it be subjected to tax? No. I gave you examples of suppose I am a salaried employee, correct? And I sold my car. My car I had bought 45 years back for 2 lakhs. Now it has become antique piece and I sold it for 50 lakhs. Will you compute capital gain? No. Why? Because for you, it is a personal effect. For you, it is a personal effect. And did you learn that capital asset includes property of any kind except stock in trade, personal effects? And therefore, although you sold your car for 50 lakhs, there is no question of taxation. There is no question of taxation. Yes, if I am a businessman and I am using the car for my business and I have sold the car, then as per section 50, you will compute capital gains if the sale consideration is greater than the opening WDV plus the additions made. Are you understanding the difference? That means if it's a personal effect, there is no tax. Now, let me ask you one more question. Suppose I wanted to sell my house. Suppose I wanted to sell my house. So let me tell you a small story. Are you interested?
Yes.
So, when I cleared chartered accountancy in 2011, my father, he gifted me one small flat in Abbots. Small flat in Abbots. So, I knew I will never go and stay in Abbots. At the same time, I knew if you sell this flat, you will get some capital. So in 2012, I put it up for sale. I still remember at that point of time, I was in Kakinada. And there one buyer called and he said, I have come to see your flat. Is it available? I said, of course it is available. He said, is there anybody to show me? I said, of course, there's a watchman there. You please go with the watchman, see the flat. If you like it, you call me back. So after an hour, he calls me and says, hey, I love the flat. I would like to take it. How much are you offering it for? I said, I'm thinking I should get around 25 lakhs. He said, oh, that's very good. Good price. So I'll do one thing. I will give you 1 lakh advance today because today is good day. And remaining 24 lakhs, I'll pay you within the next 3 months. I was also happy. 1 lakh he's paying today, 24 lakhs he's paying in the next 3 months, whatever it is. So I said, okay, no problem, please give the check to my watchman, he will deposit in my bank account. So what happened was in 2012-2013, I took advance of 1 lakh. Remember, I did not enter into an agreement, I did not transfer the possession. I only took an advance of 1 lakh. So is it a transfer? Is it a transfer as per section 53A of Transfer of Properties Act? No. Why? Unless until I give him the keys and say, go, do pandaga, do festival. Till that time, it will not be called as a transfer as per section 53A of Transfer of Properties Act. So, I came back to Hyderabad after a couple of weeks and I called him up and said, hey, why don't we meet up? Then he said, sir, small problem. Sir, what's the problem? Actually, I took my wife next day and she does not like the flat only. I said, why? He said, you know, no, sir, she's my wife. Whatever I like, she will not like. I said, congratulations. So I said, what do you want to do? Are you interested in buying it or not? He said, nay, sir, jaane do. He said, if possible, will you please return 1 lakh? Will you return 1 lakh? No. Mahesh was my friend that time. So, I called him up and said, Mahesh, should I return? He said, don't return. Once given is given. So, I also did not return. So, technically, what did I do with this 1 lakh? I forfeited this amount. What did I do? I forfeited that. A similar thing happened in 2014-2015. In 2014-2015, again when I became Kangal.com, I wanted to sell my flat. So, I put it up for sale. Again one buyer came. This time he said 35 lakhs. I said, okay, very good. He said he'll give me 1 lakh advance. I said, no Baba, last time I took 1 lakh and like this only it happened. So this time you give me 1.5 lakh. So I took advance of how much? I took advance of 1.5 lakh. Very good. 30 lakhs was the total sale consideration. Again I called him up after a couple of weeks. He said, sir, I love the flat. But my wife, she doesn't like the flat. I was thinking, what is it? Wife ka lafda? Every guy is coming, seeing the flat, loving it, and then the wife, when she goes, she is not. So I was wondering, something must be there. So in 2017-18, this year only. In 2017-18, this time what happened? When the buyer came, I said, please get your wife along with you first only. So he said, why do you want? I'll take the decision. I'm head of family. Oh, then I understood. Acha, the reason why these wives are saying it's not nice, is because the husbands are not involving them into decision making. So, the logic of the wife there is very simple. If she says okay, it means okay. If husband says okay, no okay. So, I said, no, please get your wife, sir. It's very important. So, the couple came. They loved the flat. They agreed to pay 40 lakhs. And this time, the wife gave the advance. And obviously, you know, once the lady of the house gives the advance, there is no question of forfeiture. So, end of story. Flat has been sold ultimately in which year? For how much? 40 lakhs. Kya baat hai? So, I have to now compute capital gains. Yes or no? I have to now compute capital gains. I will do it in the normal fashion. There is nothing special about this. What I will do, I'll take sale consideration. How much?
40 lakhs.
Minus obviously cost of acquisition. Now cost of acquisition, I did not purchase it. Why? Because I got it as a father had gifted it to son. So, now, if you are wondering, hey, what is the cost of acquisition? Let me teach you a new section. Section 49, subsection 1 says, in case of a gift, the cost of acquisition to the current owner shall be taken as the cost of acquisition to the previous owner. Acha. So, in my computation, when I have to find out what is the cost of acquisition, I have to go and ask whom? I have to go and ask my father, Daddy, what is the price at which you purchased this flat? He said, Varun, I bought this flat at 10 lakhs. When did he buy the flat? For 10 lakhs he bought it. And let's say he bought it in 2001, 2002. To keep things very simple. You know why I took that date. Why? That is the base year. So let's assume that he bought it for 10 lakhs in that particular year. So then I because anyways I asked him, he asked me, why are you finding out the price? I told him, Dad, as per section 49.1, I'm supposed to ask the price from you. He said, hey, are you planning to sell it? Because he also understands, he's also chartered accountant, no? So immediately when I asked him, he understood. So he said, how much are you selling it for? I said, I'm getting around 40 lakhs. He said, yeah, it's good price only. Then I told him, "Arey, Daddy, you are thinking I got 40. Actually, I got more than 40. How much I got? 41.51. I got 42.5, Dad. He said, "Arey, wait, I'll tell you one more story. You know, before I gave the flat to you know why I gave the flat to you, Varun? I said, why? Because I could not sell it. I said, what are you saying? He said, before I gave the flat to you, basically, I thought I'll sell it. And with that money, I'll buy you a luxurious car. But I could not sell the flat, so I gave you the flat. So one day I knew you will sell it and you will buy a car yourself. But so I asked him, hey, did you offer it for sale? He said, yeah, I forgot to tell you. You know, in 2010-11, I offered it and I got advance of 2 lakhs. You are a waste person, Varun. You took only 1 lakh, 1.5. Those days, I took 2 lakhs advance and that fellow did not turn up. So, I forfeited that amount. Kya baat? That means, are you saying this flat was offered 3 times in its lifetime? Yes. Flat was offered, forfeited, offered, forfeited, offered, forfeited. Ultimately, sold. Now, my question is, how much should I take as cost of acquisition? Obviously, I should take cost to the previous owner. But section 51 clears some things. What does section 51 say? Section 51 says, guys, listen carefully because this is a very important section. You will not be able to understand it on your own. It looks very small. It's like Lakshmi bomb only. Don't underestimate the section. Section 51 says, if any amount has been forfeited by the current owner, I'm repeating again, if any amount has been forfeited by the current owner which has not been taxed earlier, such amount shall be reduced from the cost of acquisition at the time of computation of capital gains. Now you tell me one thing. What is the amount that has been forfeited by the current owner? 2.5. So logically speaking, you will subtract 2.5 lakhs from 10 lakhs. Correct or not? This was the section. This was the section. This is only the section. But now there is a twist in the twist. In Finance Act 2014. Finance Act consa? 2014. They inserted one section called as 56.29. Section 56 is a charging section for IFOS. So whenever I say 56, it means income from other sources. They inserted a new section 56.29 and here they said, if any amount has been forfeited on or after 1/4/2014, If any amount has been forfeited on or after 1/4/2014, will you remember this date?
Yes.
1/4/14. Will you remember this date? No problem, no. If any amount has been forfeited on or after 1/4/14, then such amount shall be taxed in the year of forfeiture only. Such amount shall be taxed in the year of forfeiture. I'll tell you why they put this section. Do you see, my father took 2 lakhs. Was he ever taxed? Why was he not taxed in 10-11? Because it was a capital receipt. And I told you in tax, what is the rule? All revenue receipts are taxable unless exempt. Capital receipts are not taxed unless specifically taxed. There was no specific taxation for amount forfeited in the year 10-11. But when I forfeited this figure, listen carefully, when I forfeited 1.4 lakhs, 1.5 lakhs, was there a new law? What was the section? 5629. What does section 5629 say? If any amount has been forfeited on or after, then the amount forfeited will become income from other sources. Are we clear? Now, because of the amendment in section 5629, because this 1.5 lakhs pay, I already paid the tax. Now you tell me, cost of acquisition from 10 lakhs as per section 51, how much should I subtract?
1 lakh.
All of you agree 1 lakh?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, see, advance has been forfeited by my father. One second. Advance has been forfeited by my father. You did not consider this. Why? Because section 51 said any amount forfeited by current owner. Advance has been forfeited by me in 12-13, you took it into consideration. And then advance has been forfeited by me only in 14-15, you did not consider it because it was forfeited on or after 1/4/2014. So obviously it would have got taxed in that year itself under the section 5629. So overall, now my cost of acquisition is 9 lakhs. Of course, I will subject it to indexation. Why? Because it is long term. So, I will get cost of acquisition of 9x, 9 lakhs into indexation benefit, and whatever 40 minus 9x, this will be treated as my long term capital gain. Are we understanding the section? Just to repeat, section 51 says if any amount has been forfeited by the current owner which has not been subjected to tax, such amount shall be reduced from the cost of acquisition prior to indexation at the time of computation of capital gains on transfer of the asset. Section 5629 says if any amount has been forfeited on or after 1/4/2014, then it shall be taxed under the head IFRS. Did we understand? Now you ask your doubt. Now, Mahesh is asking, what happened to this previous owner's advance? Not taxed. That means my father did not pay tax then also on that 2 lakhs. He will not pay today also on that 2 lakhs. That is why they introduced a new section. I am understanding the importance.
Yes.
Let's write down. Under section 51, first bullet point. First bullet point, where any advance has been forfeited by the current owner in lieu of transfer of asset and such amount has not been subjected to tax. And such amount has not been subjected to tax. Comma. The amount forfeited shall be subtracted from the cost of acquisition. The cost of acquisition, comma, prior to indexation. Prior to indexation. Second bullet point. As per section 5629, comma, any amount forfeited on or after what date? 1-4-2014. In lieu of transfer of asset, shall be subjected to tax under the head IFOS. So now tell me one thing, can I simplify things and say if any amount has been forfeited prior to 1-4-2014, only that amount should be adjusted in the cost of acquisition? Yes. Write down. Note. In simple words, amount forfeited prior to, shall be adjusted in cost of acquisition. You want to write down the example?
Yes, sir.
Note it down. Okay. Guys, let's understand what all did we do till now. Because every time we do a little portion, we are supposed to understand where do we stand in these ocean topics. We started off with section 45 subsection 1. Here we said if there is a transfer in the previous year of transfer of a capital asset whatever gains arises will be subjected to capital gains. The term transfer we learned in section 2 clause 47. The term previous year, 2 clause 14. Then we learnt exceptions, 46 and 47. Then we learnt if certain conditions mentioned in 47 are not satisfied, then we will refer to 47A. Apart from this, we went to the computation section, that is 48. Here we learned we should take the sale consideration minus expenses on transfer minus cost of acquisition minus cost of improvement. Then we learned under section 48, how many provisos? 6 provisos. First proviso we learned, if a non-resident transfers shares in or debentures of an Indian company which originally acquired in foreign currency. Second proviso we learnt about indexation benefit. Third, we said indexation benefit is not available to bonds or debentures except capital index bonds and sovereign gold bonds. Then fourth proviso we learnt, appreciation in rupee for masala bonds, that is rupee denominated bonds, should be ignored. Fifth proviso we learnt in section 47 clause 3, when there is an employee who is transferring shares by way of gift, sale consideration shall be taken as fair market value. And sixth proviso we learned, securities transaction tax is not deductible. Then we went to section 45 subsection 1A. Section 45 subsection 1A said, hey, it will not be taxed in the previous year of damage, it will be taxed in the previous year in which the consideration is received. And for the purpose of computation, it said that sale consideration shall be taken as what? Money received plus fair market value of the asset received. See, I am writing it here and here. Why? It tells us what should be taken as sale consideration and in which year should it be taxed. What should be taken as sale consideration? Money received plus fair market value of asset received. What is the previous year? What is the year in which it should be taxed? In the year in which insurance compensation is received. Next, section 45 subsection 2 tells us that for the purpose of computation, sale consideration is the fair market value as on the date of conversion, and the tax will arise in which year? In the year in which the stock in trade is ultimately sold. Section 45 subsection 2A tells us that for the purpose of valuation, that you will use FIFO method, and it is not the legal owner, it is the beneficial owner. Okay. Then in section 45 subsection 3, we learned sale consideration shall be taken as amount that has been recorded in the books of account. 45 subsection 4, we learned sale consideration should be taken as fair market value of the asset. In section 45 subsection 5, we learned number 1, the year in which the consideration or enhanced consideration should be taxed, the year in which when you should recompute, where interest should be taxed, whether expenses can be taken as deduction, and cost of acquisition should be taken as zero. So I'll say cost of acquisition also should be taken as zero when you're doing the second time computation. Next, in section 45 subsection 5A, we learnt what? In case of joint development agreement, it is not in the previous year in which there is a transfer. It is the previous year in which there is issue of completion certificate. Are we clear? Next, after section 45 subsection 5A, we went to section 50. In case of section 50, we learnt for depreciable assets, capital gains will arise only in two conditions. Correct or not? Acha. And we also learnt that for the purpose of understanding, cost of acquisition will be taken as opening WDV plus additions made during the year. Next, as per section 50A, we learned the same thing, that the cost of acquisition should be taken as the actual cost, because sale consideration minus actual cost, then only capital gains will arise. 50B, we learned what is slump sale. Basically, we will not follow section 48. We have an alternative in case of slump sale, and that is section 50B. Correct or not? Only thing, instead of taking cost of acquisition, we take net worth. and we know how to find out net worth, assets minus liabilities. 50C, what did we learn? If the sale consideration is less than the stamp duty value, that means relating to sale consideration, we learned if the sale consideration is less than stamp duty value, then the stamp duty value should be taken as the sale consideration. 50CA, in case of transfer of unquoted shares, we learned if the sale consideration is less than the fair market value, then we should take sale consideration as the fair market value. Then 50D, we said if you are not able to find out the sale consideration, then take the fair market value of the asset that you have transferred. Next, section 51, we learned how to adjust cost of acquisition. See, everything that you are learning, we are learning for a reason. So, have the sections become your friends? By looking at the sections now, are you able to have eye contact and say, hey, I recognize you? Yes or no? Or are these looking like Greek and Latin only? No. So, if now only you are able to understand and identify the sections, definitely over a period of 3-4 months, you should be able to, you know, be perfect in these sections. Don't get scared, just read again and again and again. Now, because you've revised capital gains almost for almost a week, yes, so that confidence has slowly come now. Okay, tomorrow test ke baad, day after tomorrow test ke baad, confidence will be even more higher.
Sir.
If you study. If you don't study, matash. So now what are we going to learn from now? We are going to learn in certain cases what is cost of acquisition and what is cost of improvement. These two terms have been defined in section 55. I want you to come to section 55, subsection 1. And by the way, this table, where are you writing? First page. First page under the charging section. Summary notes for this chapter. There you want to update the table, please update. Come on, come to page number 89, section 55, subsection 1. Can you see clause B, cost of improvement? Now let me read it. It says, in respect to a capital asset being goodwill of a business, it's underlined, put down number 1. Right to manufacture, produce or process any article or thing, number 2. Right to carry on any business, number 3, shall be taken to be nil. Kya baat hai? He's saying cost of improvement for these three shall always be taken as nil. What are the three? Tell me. Number 1, goodwill of business. Number 2, right to manufacture, process any article or thing. Number 3, right to carry any business or profession. Achha. And then he says, and in relation to any other capital assets, matlab other than these three, where the capital asset became the property of the previous owner or the SSC before 1-4-2001, means all expenditure of a capital nature incurred in making any additions or alterations to the capital asset on or after the said date by the previous owner or the SSC. And in any other case, means all expenditure of capital nature incurred in making any additions or alterations to the capital asset by the SSC after it became his property, and where the capital asset became the property of the SSC by any mode specified in section 49, subsection 1, that is gift, will, inheritance, by the previous owner, but does not include any expenditure which is deductible in computing the income chargeable, and the expression improvement shall be construed accordingly. Very complicated language, I say. Someone should simplify this. Thank God it's so complicated. So that someone is required in life. Very simple. He says, in respect of the three assets, what are the three assets?
Goodwill
of business, right to manufacture, produce or process any article or thing, right to carry on business or profession. Obviously, you will take the cost of improvement is equal to nil. Now, in respect of the other assets, you remember only so much. Either it could be acquired in a mode prescribed under section 49(1) or others, by gift or others. My father gave it to me, will come under 49(1). I bought it myself, will come under?
Yes.
If my father gave it to me, cost of improvement will be cost of improvement by me plus cost of improvement by my father. So technically, cost of improvement is equal to cost of improvement by current owner plus cost of improvement by previous owner. Samjhaya? If it is others, then cost of improvement is equal to cost of improvement by current owner. Correct? But one thing you must remember, whether it is this or it is this or it is this, if improvement is prior to 1/4/2001, it was 1981 up to Finance Act 2016, and you know they changed the base year. Therefore, if improvement is prior to 1/4/2001, what should you do? You should not consider it. Are we clear? So let me take an example, because flowchart everyone thinks, hey, so easy. Yeah. Let me take one example and see if you understood what I wanted you to understand. Let us say my father gave me a house in 2011. Before he gave the house to me, he purchased it way back, let's say, in 2001 for 10 lakhs. Beech mein, he did some furnishing. And furnishing was worth 3 lakhs. Correct? And after that, I also did some furnishing. Let us say 4 lakhs. And then I sold it. Okay. Tell me, what is cost of improvement?
7 lakhs.
Will you take this as well as this?
Yes.
What if I told you my father bought it in 1975? In 1976, he did furnishing for 1 lakh. In 2003, he did furnishing of 3 lakhs. And then I did furnishing of 4 lakhs. What is cost of improvement?
7 lakhs.
Why 7 lakhs? Why did you not take 1 lakh? 1 lakh, ignore. Correct or not? Super. That means you understood whatever those paragraphs say. Is it easier in paragraph format or flowchart? Copy then. Come to the next page and you will see the term cost of acquisition. Yeah, there is subsection 2. cost of acquisition. In that he says, in relation to a capital asset being goodwill of a business, put number one, trademark, number two, brand name, number three, right to manufacture, produce or process any article or thing, number four, right to carry on any business or profession, number five, tenancy rights, number six, stage carriage permits, number seven, and lumars, number eight. So how many intangibles are we talking about?
Eight.
For these eight intangibles, what does he say? In case of acquisition of such asset by an SSE by purchase from a previous owner, it means the purchase price. And in any other case, it shall be taken to be nil. So technically, what it's saying is that for these eight intangibles, there can only be two scenarios. Either it is self-generated, or it has been purchased. If it is self-generated, cost of acquisition shall be taken as nil. If it is purchased, cost of acquisition should be taken as? Is this simple? What are the eight intangibles? Tell me. Number one. Number two. Number three. Number four. Number five. Number six. Number seven. Number eight. Copy. Can I go ahead? In clause AA, he says, in a case where, by virtue of holding a capital asset, being a share or any other security, the SSE becomes entitled to subscribe to any additional financial asset or is allotted any additional financial asset without any payment, then subject to the provisions of subclause 1 and 2 of clause B, 1, 2, 3, 3A and 4 is given. Let me ask you whether you know the concept of right shares and bonus shares. Have you heard these terms before? Right shares, bonus shares. What do you mean by right shares? For the existing shareholders, the company will issue rights. Correct or not? Now the existing shareholders have an option. Either they subscribe for those shares or they can simply sell off their rights. Correct or not? Why do they want the existing shareholders only to buy shares again? Very simple logic. They don't want to dilute the company. They don't want to dilute the shareholding and introduce new members to the company. For example, let us say three of us, we are in the company. Just on a smaller level, I'm taking example. Let's say only three of us are there in the company. And we hold 30%, 40%, 30%. Now the company needs 10 more lakh rupees. One option we have, we can offer in public. But if you do that, what will happen? Our percentage in the company will fall down. So we'll do one thing. First, we'll raise amongst us all, you know. I'll say, come on, 30% I will give 3 lakhs, 40% you give 4 lakhs, 30% you give 3 lakhs. Suppose you don't want to give. Suppose you don't have or you don't want to give. It's okay. You can sell your rights to another shareholder. Are we clear? So, right shares is basically rights given to the existing shareholders who can either exercise the rights or they can relinquish their right by transfer to another person. On the other hand, what is bonus share? Bonus share is nothing but capitalization of profits. So what happens is the company passes one very simple accounting entry called as profit and loss, sorry, a general reserve account debit to capital account. And they will issue bonus shares to the shareholders. Must be in 1:1 ratio, 1:2. Ratio can be whatever it is. That means, is the shareholder getting something? He's getting shares. But that is only psychological. Is there any value, money that he is getting?
No.
One share now became two shares. Clear? So, bonus shares, no amount is paid by the shareholder to the company. At the same time, company also does not pay anything to the shareholder. So now let me ask you one very simple question. What is the cost of acquisition? Think and answer. We are not playing fastest fingers first. What is the cost of acquisition of a bonus share? Is the shareholder paying anything for the bonus share? What is the cost of acquisition of bonus share? Acha. What is the cost of acquisition of the rights entitlement? Are you paying anything for getting the right to buy a share? In rights issue, does the shareholder pay anything for getting the right to buy the share? Or do all existing shareholders get by default? Yes or no? That means what is the cost of acquisition? Beautiful. Asa, tell me one thing. What is the cost of acquisition of buying a right share by an existing shareholder? Basically, whatever is the rights issue price. Suppose the company says, guys, we are going to issue shares and every right share is going to be 100 rupees. So what is the rights issue price? 100. What is the cost that the shareholder has to pay? 100 rupees to get the share. So can I say it is nothing but the rights issue price? Now this is the most interesting. If you can answer this, that means you understood everything. Cost of acquisition of the right share to the new shareholder. Correct or not? Whatever is the rights issue price, because this is the amount that he will be paying to the company, but before paying to the company, does he pay for the rights entitlement also?
Yes.
So can I say amount paid to purchase rights entitlement correct or not? Any doubt in these 4 points? Any doubt in these 4 points? Are you sure? Cost of acquisition of bonus share is equal to nil. Cost of acquisition of rights entitlement is equal to nil. Cost of acquisition of right shares by existing shareholder is equal to rights issue price. Cost of acquisition of right share by new shareholder is equal to rights issue price plus the amount that he has paid for purchasing the rights entitlement. Are we clear? Now sometimes what happens, companies do reorganization. Have you heard of reorganization? Have you heard of splitting of shares? Yes. Have you heard of consolidation of shares? Yes. Suppose, Mahesh, suppose you bought 2 shares in Reliance Industries. Correct? Each share you bought for 1,000 rupees. Now the company said, all our shares are going to get consolidated. For every 2 shares that you hold, we will give you 1 new share. What is the cost of the new share?
Yeah.
It's nothing but the cost of acquisition of the 2 old shares. Correct or not? So, I'm not going to write that down. That's simple logic. But these 4, are we clear? Cost of acquisition of bonus share is equal to nil. Cost of acquisition of right share is, rights entitlement is equal to nil. Cost of acquisition of rights issue, right share to an existing shareholder in the issue is called rights issue price. Cost of acquisition of the right share to the new shareholder shall be taken as rights issue price plus amount paid for the rights entitlement. And if you see the wordings of the law, it says subject to provisions of subclause 1 and subclause 2 of clause B. Yes or no? Let me explain to you what do subclause 1 and subclause 2 of clause B even say. Guys, listen carefully because this is going to change the way you think about bonus shares. Because this question is definitely going to come in your exam. Subclause 1 and subclause 2 state, if an asset has been acquired prior to 1/4/2001, obviously earlier it used to be 1/4/1981. If an asset has been acquired prior to 1/4/2001, then you have an option either to take the actual cost of acquisition or the fair market value as on 1/4/1981. Sorry, as on 2001. My bad. So you have an option. So last 5 years I've been screaming 1981. So it's become 1981. So anyways, again, if an asset has been acquired prior to 1/4/2001, the SSE has an option. Either he takes the actual cost of acquisition or he takes the fair market value as on 1/4/2001. So let me give you an example and see if you can answer. Think carefully and answer. Don't be in a hurry. In the year 1995-96, I had bought 100 shares of Reliance Industries. I had bought 100 shares of Reliance Industries. In 98-99, the company gave a bonus issue of 1:1. The 100 shares I bought at 300 rupees per share. And then I got bonus issue of how much? 1:1. What is 1:1? For every one share, Fukatame, you will get one share. You will get one share free of cost. Acha. As of 1/4/2001, the fair market value of the share of Reliance was 600 rupees. Let us assume that all these share certificates I am holding as of today. And how many share certificates do I have now? Or how many shares I have now?
200.
I have 200 shares. Very good. I have 200 share certificates. In 2017-18, I had sold 150 shares, out of which 100 are the old shares and 50 are the bonus shares. I know cost of acquisition of the 100 old shares are 300 rupees per share. No need to tell. But I also know that the fair market value as on 1/4/2001 is 600. So you tell me, should I take 300 or 600?
600.
Which is advantageous? Which will give you less capital gains?
600
will give you lesser capital gains. So because the asset was acquired prior to 1/4/2001, you have an option. Either you take the actual cost of acquisition or you take the fair market value as on 1/4/2001. So I will take 600. Now tell me, remaining 50 are bonus shares. What is the cost of acquisition? That is why they wrote subject to subclass 1 and subclass 2 of class B. In other words, this option is there for all of these. This option of taking fair market value as on 1/4/2001 is there for bonus share. It can't be there for right share, because right shares within 6 months you have to sell. For right share by existing shareholder and right share by new shareholder. Are we understanding? So now you tell me, for 50 shares, what should I take as the cost of acquisition? 600 rupees. Samajh mein aaya? Although the actual cost is nil as per section 55 subsection 2 clause A. As per section 55 subsection 2 clause AA, cost of acquisition is nil. But because it has been subjected to subclause 1 and subclause 2 of clause B, we have an option to take the fair market value as on 1/4/2001, and we will take which one, whichever is higher. So that's why, can I say, in respect of this, this and this, can I say, read along with what? Section 55, subsection 2, clause B, subclause 1 and subclause 2. Too complicated, sir. Higher of actual cost of acquisition if acquired before 1/4/2001 or fair market value as on 1/4/2001. Are we clear? Any doubts? No? So do you have enough place? Where? Down. Where? Go to the next page. Page number 92. There you write down. Analysis.